Hi, my name is Jay Martin. Thanks for watching this YouTube video. I want to do something a little different this time. Instead of giving you a complete game, this game I wanted to, there's really interesting stuff in this game, but instead of showing you the entire game, which is very long, what I want to do is give you a snippet of that game. And this is a very interesting stuff happens here, and I think that'll give me an opportunity to touch on some concepts, and maybe we can focus on a couple particular issues a little more in depth rather than just kind of present an entire game and touch on the issues tangentially, which is kind of what winds up happening a lot. Okay, this is a 3 versus 4 game. Let me zoom you back out. Playing with me is Triphammer and BuzzFuzz on the left, and this is me on the right. The situation that we're dealing with is here on the extreme right is one French player, and this player is moving their entire army. You can look at the minimap here. They're moving their entire army to get around my flank here. This is the second French player, and you notice that a good contingent, about 5 units of infantry, are coming down this way on my left flank. And let me show you the dots. These are me, and then Triphammer's army starts right there, and then Trip is obviously facing here. So the situation again is a complete French army coming this direction, and then another force coming through here. I have about 6 units of infantry in position here in this forest to blunt the French guy, and then I have another 7 or 8 infantry lined up here. The first concept I want to talk about is the ability to recognize the situations that you get in. And the earlier that you're able to, what is situational awareness, I guess? And the earlier that you're able to recognize the situation that you're in, the better off you will be. At this point in the game, when this game is going on, Trip Hammer and I were talking to each other, and we were like, man, we are going to get fucked. Because if we let this game continue as it, if we don't change what we're doing, if I just keep 6 infantry here against the entire French guy, if I try to get my lights to fight here, both of which are bad ideas, then we are like, man, we're going to lose if we don't continue. So the first thing is you really have to be able to recognize the situation you're in and that if things continue on their present course, what will happen? And if things continue on the present course I'm in right now, bad things are going to happen because this French guy is already giving me a pretty fair fight here. And he's got, this is like 6 units of Young Guard right here that he is looking to swing over onto my right. So an important part of that situational awareness is figuring out what the enemy is capable of and what you're capable of and how you want to react to that. So let's get the game moving a little bit this side, this attack here. The second thing is that you have to be able to change plans. I think I mentioned in a video a while ago that too many players in 1v1 games on grassy just run their army forward in the formation that they've kind of chosen for that game, and that's not ideal. You can see me making a mistake here. I'm going to try to move my light infantry up to engage in this hill, and Triphammer pretty quickly decides that that's a bad idea, and he suggests that I move all of my army over here to fight the French guy, and you can see him moving a bunch of his units here. The plan that we adopted, or the plan that we changed to, was for me to push my entire army right, and then Triphammer to occupy this forest to prevent this group of units from coming down. That's kind of a big risk for us. I'll get to this scenario in a minute, but that's a huge risk for us because Trip is already facing, but that means that I'm going to be isolated against one player, leaving a 3v2 here. So this is a risky play. The gamble we made here was based on the premise that, well, if we continue like this, we're going to get destroyed. So we have to do something drastic, and we were hoping that I could get over there and put a crunch on that guy. Hopefully, is the only way we're going to do it. So the case study as we continue is, you can see my lights are moving into the forest here, is can, with the new plan, we've recognized a weakness, recognized a problem, and we're redeploying forces to meet that. This does create a few problems for us, and let's get into kind of the next situation. The biggest concept I want to leave you with is the idea that when you're presented with an opportunity, you have to take advantage of it. For us, the opportunity was to move all of my army here. I have the advantage of the forest, so this should be good for us, right? You have to take advantage of opportunities when they're given to you. The French guy is trying to envelop me on the right. He's continuing to move his infantry around. But they've created a weakness. And this is actually really similar to the previous game I posted where a weird salient developed. let me pause the game here to talk about this. Whenever you lose communication with your partners or you don't have a straight line, you create little hinges in your line. Talk about hinges a lot. The real advantage to staying in communication with your partner is that you have one uninterrupted line and it's impossible for you to get flanked. Now, the French team here has done an interesting thing. As this player has repped all the way around their left, our right, they've created a gap in between these two players. They have lost communication with these two players. This is going to create an opportunity for me to move players into a salient here and get on the flank of the French army here. You see what I'm talking about? But if I do that, then I obviously, the counter there, is I'm going to lose contact with Trip Hammer here, and this is going to give an opportunity for the French player there to turn onto my rear, right? I mean, this makes sense. It can go both ways. The concept is who can best take advantage of their opportunities. Our opportunity is to get on this French player's flank. Their opportunity is to follow that maneuver by getting on my flank here. And whichever team takes best advantage of that opportunity, you think should be able to win the game. So let's continue. The flank continues to develop here as he pushes more infantry this direction and I push more of my infantry this direction. So the right side of the line is going to wind up as sort of a stalemate. You can see three more young guard coming this direction, and I'm pushing more infantry this direction as well. Let me try to give you blue dots. In the center, there is just a firefight going on. And if I can get the mouse to move, you can see this French player is doing a smart thing. He's advancing down the field here, and then this is me making the companion movement to get on the flank here. Now, if this French player divested all of these resources in a push down the field, you can see me running away there. And honestly, Tripp and I didn't do a really good job of positioning his forces here. I think there's a huge opportunity for this French team to make a push this direction. Now, this kind of gets complicated because depending on how he makes that advance, Tripp could get back on his flank in this direction. It's kind of an interesting scenario, right? But you can see, let me slow you down to play. I want to show you this. I've exploited the flank. He's having to withdraw, and this infantry unit, this young guard on his is getting hit really hard because I've got a preponderance of firepower, three units shooting at one, right? So my flanking maneuver here has already been a success. You can see him reorienting his line, right? But the real weakness of this team, and he's kind of doing it, I don't think that unit's actually shooting, but if this guy had moved down this direction, then we would be doing pretty good. Now, in order to exploit this flanking move, I have to keep pushing farther and farther and farther into the salient, creating more and more opportunity for this French guy to move, right? But this French guy, the flaw here in this team is that they don't do that. Now, he's kind of moving some lights down to play a little bit, but that's about it, right? And right now, the flanking maneuver on this guy is going to be pretty complete. Now, he does have better infantry than me. That's a young guard and a guard seaman against basic foot. But I do have three units shooting against two. And as he's pulling light infantry away to try to shore this up, I mean, he recognizes a weakness here. That's just going to weaken him in the center where I have a hammer of lights going on. And you can see that I'm actually moving two more infantry units this direction. One of them I'm going to try to use to protect my rear, right, which is taking fire. So that is working. But Trip, like we predicted, you know, he moved to attack my flank here, and Trip is going to try to control that. If Trip Hammer here can control these five units with these three, one of which is a fucking militia, I guess there's a cold stream in there. But that's a pretty profitable trade for us, right? Because Trip Hammer, ooh, there's six units there. So Trip Hammer is virtually eliminating six of their units on the field with three of his. That's a really good example of generating a virtual positional advantage, right? Really good example. Now, on the right, this is kind of interesting because he extends his line, and he theoretically could have made a move right here because he has five young guard against three of my foot with a bunch of cav. I think that an aggressive move for this player would have been good, but instead he gives me time to send more infantry this direction. So this winds up kind of being a stalemate. I'm pretty willing to let my 6 foot sit up against his five or four young guard and one Polish and three cav. So again, that's generating virtual advantage for us, right? Because I have six units holding down about eight of his. In the meantime, you can see that I've got light infantry with a range advantage just peppering away at that young guard, and I'm going to get really good hits on that young guard. So back to this area, And this is really what I wanted to talk about. I thought this is the interesting part of the battle, or one of them. There's some interesting shit going on the other flank, honestly, but I don't have time to get around to that. But the point I want to make is that we recognized the situation was bad, so we adjusted plans accordingly. That was the shift of my whole army left. And then the third issue is that if you want to be successful in these type of games, you have to take opportunities that are given to you. The French kind of muffed an opportunity there, the kind of muffed an opportunity there, and then we had an opportunity to move in the flank here, and we took it. And that's really it. And what I think is really interesting about, I love playing these 3v4 games, and I like playing games on, you know, maps like this. I think Homestead is a pretty interesting map because this will present you with some choices. You're going to have to make choices. It's not like a 3v3 in Grassy where you attack up the flank and it's really just a tactical question of who uses their cav best, yada, yada. Here you got to make some, I don't think they're purely strategic decisions, but you have to make some kind of decisions that affect the flow of the game. And at this point, the French have lost their opportunity to exploit the salient that I created. At this point, I'm able to wrap around to such a degree on this French guy that the second French player here really doesn't have an opportunity to move all the way over here. Would take way too long and certainly would open up the flank for Tripphammer to advance on him, right? And real simple decisions, sorry about the quick zoom there, but real little simple decisions, I think, resulted in this game turning into a rout. I'm going to wind up destroying this French army without losing a single unit. I'm going to wipe this entire French army off the field without losing a unit. And we were solely able to do that because we took the opportunity to create good positional advantage. And we had some tactical things going for me. I was in a forest. He wasn't, yada, yada, yada. But the lack of opportunity that's taken, and I say this a lot too, that the real reason to be attack-oriented, or, you know, a lot of players just will sit there and they will camp no matter what happens. But if you're going to take advantage of those opportunities, you have to be willing to attack. You have to put your ass out there. And, you know, players that just camp or whatever, or first of all, if you're just a camper, you're missing a ton of the interesting part of this game. I mean, this is a really fucking interesting computer game, and you're missing 99% of its depth if you just sit there and camp. You need to fix, you know, you need to get out there and maneuver. You know, that is what's interesting. That's what's interesting. And I thought that this little case in point of us able to create the salient here was a really interesting case to think about. And then, you know, another thing to think about is the whole stay in communication with your team. You know, this opportunity was created for us because this French player tried to make a really aggressive move around the flank where he lost communication with his partner. And in that aggressive move, he allowed himself to get flanked again. Now, there's two ways you can look at that, is that this attack could have been successful if you would have been faster, if you would have performed this maneuver on the flank better, but, you know, he didn't move quite fast enough, and as a result, we were able to move a little faster and catch him in that situation. So, you know, taking advantage of your opportunities and moving really quick. And here, a little too late, the French guy, you know, does start to maneuver down the field. I think that I'm going to be able to turn units to fire on this guy's flank here, so nothing good, really good is going to come out of that, is kind of the problem. And you can watch here, this will be the final reduction of the French pair on the extreme right. And in a minute, when that happens, the second French player is going to run for the hills and retreat back into this section of the map, which honestly is not a winning solution. You know, it's just not a winning solution. If you're curious, here's a cursory look. BuzzFuzz really kicks a fuck ton of ass in this game. Buzz pretty much handles up on 1.5 or 2 complete armies. Buzz was talking about, and he pretty much said that concept of virtual advantage is, you know, how he was able to do it on his flank. The same way that we generated virtual advantage here with Trip holding off 6 units with 3. You know, if you can do that, that's how you win games. You know, if you're able to create virtual advantage by pinning down more of their forces than you're devoting with yours, that will allow you to put more units on one of their areas, and that's how you win games. You focus firepower in a particular area, and that's how you win. Yeah, that's how you win. I think I'm going to end the video there. You can see this is me making the attack on the young guard on the right, and once I can get those young guard dead, I mean, problem is moving units. That unit, it was not really laggy, but the kind of lag where you give a unit an order and it'll go somewhere you didn't want it to. So that's it. The young guard here is going to fold pretty quick. And this guy is dead in the center. That chasseur is going to get eaten by the calf. And then he just has the one Polish there. So that is the end of the French player on the right. And so, you know, a lot of lessons you can take from this. But I thought it was an interesting game. So anyway, thanks for watching. And I'm Jay Martin. Bye.